Hello everyone, this is Dr. Adel Bondok, Professor of Anatomy and Neuroscience, Mansoura University, Egypt. I will talk about the peritoneum. What is the peritoneum? What is the organization of the peritoneum? It is organized into two layers, parietal layer and the visceral layer. Okay, we'll talk about the peritoneal folds like lesser omentum and the greater omentum. Functions, blood supply and the nerve supply, then the peritoneal cavity and the peritoneal recesses or spaces. Regarding the peritoneum, the definition of the peritoneum is a serous membrane lining the abdominal wall and surrounding the viscera. Lining the abdominal wall, anterior abdominal wall, and the posterior abdominal wall and surrounding the viscera. Okay, this is the ascending colon. Okay, this is the parietal layer of the peritoneum, and this is the visceral layer of the peritoneum. So it is a serous membrane like the pleura, okay, and the pericardium. Regarding the organization, it is organized into two layers, parietal layer lining the abdominal wall, anterior abdominal wall and the posterior abdominal wall, and the visceral layer surrounding the viscera and the form folds which suspend the organ from the posterior abdominal wall. The space between the parietal layer and the visceral layer is the peritoneal cavity. Okay, regarding the peritoneal folds which suspend the organs from the posterior abdominal wall, I will talk about the formation and the names. Regarding the formation, some organs are retroperitoneal, are covered only anteriorly with peritoneum. So these organs, like the kidney, they don't have peritoneal fold. Other organs are also retroperitoneal, like the ascending colon and the descending colon. They are covered in front and the sides with peritoneum. So these organs, they don't have folds. Okay, this is the ascending colon covered in front and the sides. Okay, ascending colon, descending colon covered in front and the sides. So they don't have folds. Other organs like the small intestine are completely covered with peritoneum and suspended from the posterior abdominal wall by a fold of peritoneum, which is called the mesentery. This one, this is the mesentery. Okay? Regarding the names, if the fold is attached to the stomach, it is called the omentum. So omentum in case of the stomach, like the lesser omentum and the greater omentum. Okay, if it is attached to the small intestine, okay, this is the small intestine, okay, it is called the mesentery. If it is attached to the colon, it is called the mesocolon. If it is attached to the large intestine, okay, mesocolon. If it is attached to the liver and the spleen, it's called the ligament, like falciform ligament between the liver and the anterior abdominal wall. Coronary and the triangular ligaments between the liver and the diaphragm, gastrosplenic ligament between the spleen and the stomach, and the lienorenal ligament between the spleen and the kidney. So we have seven major peritoneal folds. The seven major peritoneal folds are, okay, this is the liver, stomach, transverse colon, and the pancreas. The first one is the lesser omentum. This is the lesser omentum between the liver and the stomach. It is also called the gastrohepatic ligament. Okay? Second one, this one, it is the greater omentum. The greater omentum connecting the stomach with the transverse colon. We can call it gastrocolic ligament. The third one is the mesentery of the small intestine between the small intestine and the posterior abdominal wall. Okay, this is the mesentery of the small intestine. And then transverse mesocolon and also sigmoid mesocolon. Okay, and falciform ligament between the liver and the anterior abdominal wall. And gastrosplenic ligament between the spleen and the stomach, and the lienorenal ligament between the spleen and the kidney. We'll see these ligaments in the other slides. Okay, regarding the omenta, lesser omentum, this is the stomach, okay? This is the stomach. Lesser omentum, this is the lesser omentum, and this is the greater omentum, okay? Greater omentum. So lesser omentum and the greater omentum. Regarding the lesser omentum, this is the lesser omentum. The lesser omentum, it extends between the lesser curvature of the stomach. This is the lesser curvature of the stomach and the first part of the duodenum, okay? Lesser curvature and the first part of the duodenum to the liver, where? To fissure for ligamentum venosum and the porta hepatis. This lesser omentum has two parts. One connecting the liver with the stomach. This part is called the gastrohepatic ligament or hepatogastric ligament. Okay? The other one connecting the liver with the duodenum, hepatoduodenal ligament. So hepatogastric ligament and the hepatoduodenal ligaments are the two parts of the lesser omentum. I will talk about the details when I discuss the stomach. Then this is the greater omentum. Okay, greater omentum, and this also the greater omentum. The greater omentum is formed of four layers. Anterior two layers and the posterior two layers. It extends from the greater curvature of the stomach. This is the stomach. Okay? Stomach. It extends between the greater curvature of the stomach till the transverse colon. This is the transverse colon. Okay? Anterior two layers and the posterior two layers. And between the anterior two layers and the posterior two layers is the cavity of the lesser sac. Okay? So the greater omentum between the greater curvature of the stomach and the transverse colon. Then the mesocolon. This is the transverse colon. Okay? And this is the transverse mesocolon. Transverse mesocolon actually connecting the transverse colon with the body of the pancreas. Okay? Transverse mesocolon. So regarding the colon. Which parts of the colon have mesocolon? This is the first one. This is the transverse mesocolon. Okay? It's attached to the transverse colon. This is the second one. It is the sigmoid mesocolon. It is attached to the sigmoid colon. And this is the third one. It is the mesoappendix. Okay? It is the mesentery or of the appendix. Okay? So we have three parts of the colon have mesocolon, transverse colon, sigmoid colon, and appendix. So these parts are mobile. The transverse colon is mobile, the sigmoid colon is mobile, and the appendix is also mobile. Okay, this is a cross section of the abdomen. This is the liver, this is the stomach, spleen, and the kidney. Okay, so of course, okay, between the liver and the anterior abdominal wall, this ligament is the falciform ligament. Okay, between the stomach and the spleen, this is the gastrosplenic ligament or gastrosplenic omentum. This between the spleen and the kidney, it is the lienorenal ligament. Okay, and this is the falciform ligament between the liver and the anterior abdominal wall. And this is the lesser omentum, okay? What are the functions of the peritoneum? Okay, the first function is protection of the abdominal organs. It maintains their position by suspending them by ligaments. So protection and maintaining their position, the position of the abdominal organs. Second one. It secretes a fluid, peritoneal fluid, or serous fluid. Lubrication, it lubricates the surface of the organs by secreting serous fluid to prevent the friction between the organs. The greater omentum, this one, the greater omentum is called the policeman of the abdomen. It fights intra-abdominal infection and it provides passages for blood vessels, lymphatics, and the nerves to the viscera. So protection maintains the position of the organs, lubrication of the surface of the organs to prevent friction, policeman of the abdomen is the greater omentum, and to provide passages for blood vessels, lymphatics, and the nerves to the viscera. Regarding the blood supply and the nerve supply of the peritoneum, parietal layer and visceral layer. Parietal layer is similar to the abdominal wall. Visceral layer is similar to the viscera. So the parietal layer, yes, parietal layer is similar to the body wall in blood supply and the nerve supply. Visceral layer is similar to the viscera in blood supply and the nerve supply. So the nerve supply of the parietal layer is from the nerve supply of the abdominal wall. Lower six thoracic nerves, okay? And then L1, iliohypogastric and the ilioinguinal nerves, and also the phrenic nerve to the roof of the peritoneum or of the peritoneal cavity. Regarding the visceral layer, it is supplied by autonomic nerves of the related viscera. Regarding the blood supply, okay, because the parietal layer is supplied by somatic nerves, it is painful, it is sensitive to pain, and the visceral layer is sensitive only to stretch. It is not sensitive to pain, but to stretch. Regarding the blood supply, the parietal layer is supplied by the arteries of the body wall. The visceral layer is supplied by the arteries of the related viscera. Regarding the lymph drainage, same. Lymph drainage, the parietal layer drains into the lymphatics of the body wall. The visceral layer drains into the lymphatics of the related viscera. Then we'll talk about the peritoneal cavity. The peritoneal cavity is the cavity between, or is the potential space between the parietal layer and the visceral layer of the peritoneum. This peritoneal cavity in the male is completely closed sac. So it is completely closed sac in the males. How about the females? In the females, it is not completely closed because the uterine tubes open into the peritoneal cavity. So the peritoneal cavity is the space between the parietal layer, potential space between parietal layer and the visceral layer. It is completely closed sac in the males. It is not completely closed in the females because the uterine tubes open into the peritoneal cavity. Regarding the contents of the peritoneal cavity, the peritoneal cavity normally contains thin film of serous fluid. This serous fluid is formed of water, electrolytes, leukocytes, and antibodies. But the peritoneal cavity may contain abnormal collection of fluid. So abnormal collection of what? Abnormal collection, excessive serous fluid, which is called ascites. Okay, so excessive serous fluid, ascites, or pus in case of peritonitis, inflammation, or blood in case of internal hemorrhage. So the contents of the peritoneal cavity, normally it contains only thin film of serous fluid for lubrication of the organs, but abnormal collection like ascites, like in ascites, okay, excessive serous fluid, or pus in case of peritonitis, or blood in case of internal hemorrhage. Regarding the divisions of the peritoneal cavity, liver, stomach, transverse colon, and this is the pancreas. Okay? The peritoneal cavity is divided into two sacs. The first one is called the lesser sac or omental bursa, and the lesser sac is located behind the stomach. This is the lesser sac. Okay, lesser sac, omental bursa, and the second sac is the greater sac, which is the main part. Okay, it is anterior to the stomach, between the stomach and the anterior abdominal wall. So lesser sac behind the stomach, greater sac in front of the stomach. The two sacs are completely separated from each other except at the epiploic foramen, where the two sacs communicate. Okay, this is the epiploic foramen. So the divisions of the peritoneal cavity, it is divided into greater sac, which is the main part, and the lesser sac behind the stomach, and the two sacs communicate by epiploic foramen. Regarding the lesser sac, this is the liver, stomach, transverse colon, and the pancreas. Regarding the lesser sac, it is located behind the stomach. So this is the lesser sac. So what are the boundaries? Okay, anterior wall of the lesser sac, this is the anterior wall of the lesser sac, four structures. The first structure is this one, lesser omentum. So anterior wall, lesser omentum. And then the stomach. And then the anterior two layers. Okay, lesser omentum. Okay, caudate lobe of the liver. So first, caudate lobe of the liver, lesser omentum, stomach, and then the anterior two layers. Okay, stomach, and then anterior two layers of the greater omentum. So anterior layer, anterior wall of the lesser sac, four structures. Caudate lobe of the liver, lesser omentum, posterior surface of the stomach, and anterior two layers of the greater omentum. The posterior wall, also four structures. Okay, posterior wall, this is the posterior wall. Okay, so number one, posterior two layers of the greater omentum, then the transverse colon, then the transverse mesocolon, and then the structures in front, the structures forming the stomach bed. Okay, or peritoneum covering the stomach bed. Regarding the roof, this is the roof. It is the reflection of the peritoneum. Okay, okay, so it is the peritoneum lining the diaphragm. Regarding the floor, it is the space between the anterior two layers and the posterior two layers of the greater omentum. Again, boundaries of the lesser sac. Liver, stomach, transverse colon, peritoneum. Anterior wall, four structures. Okay, this is the lesser sac. So anterior wall, four structures. This is the first one. Okay, it is the caudate lobe of the liver. This is the lesser omentum. Posterior surface of the stomach. Anterior two layers of the greater omentum. Then the posterior wall, four structures. Posterior two layers of the greater omentum, transverse colon, transverse mesocolon, and then peritoneum covering the stomach bed. Okay, in front of the body of the pancreas. The transverse mesocolon connects the transverse colon with the body of the pancreas. Then the roof. It is the peritoneum lining the diaphragm. Then the floor. Okay, it is the inferior recess. It is the peritoneum, it is the space between anterior two layers and the posterior two layers of the greater omentum. Again, boundaries of the lesser sac. Left side and right side. Right border, this is the right border of the lesser sac. It is the right border of the greater omentum. This is the right border of the greater omentum in the lower part. And in the upper part, it is the epiploic foramen. It is the opening to the lesser sac. Regarding the left border, lower part is the left border of the greater omentum. This is the left border of the greater omentum. Okay. And the upper part is the angle between two ligaments. Angle between gastrosplenic ligament and lienorenal ligament. So this is the splenic recess of the lesser sac, splenic recess. Regarding the epiploic foramen, this is the epiploic foramen, okay? Anterior wall of the epiploic foramen is the free margin of the lesser omentum. And the free margin of the lesser omentum contains three structures. So free margin of the lesser omentum containing three structures. The first one is the bile duct, anterior and to the right. Second one is the hepatic artery, anterior and to the left. And third one is the portal vein behind the duct and the artery. So the anterior wall of the epiploic foramen, if you put your finger in the epiploic foramen, the structures in front of your finger are three. Bile duct, anterior and to the right, hepatic artery, anterior and to the left, and the portal vein behind the two. Posteriorly, it is the inferior vena cava. Superiorly, it is the caudate process of the caudate lobe of the liver. And inferiorly, it is the first part of the duodenum. So this is the epiploic foramen. Again, epiploic foramen. This is the lesser omentum. Okay? This is the lesser sac. This is the splenic recess of the lesser sac. And this is the epiploic foramen. So anterior. This is the gastrosplenic ligament. And this is the lienorenal ligament. Okay, splenic recess. So anteriorly, it is the free margin of the lesser omentum. This free margin of the lesser omentum contains the three structures. Bile duct anterior and to the right, hepatic artery anterior and to the left, and the portal vein behind the two. Posteriorly, it is the inferior vena cava. And this is the splenic recess of the lesser sac. Regarding the greater sac, the green structure, greater sac, it is divided by the lesser omentum, the stomach, the greater omentum, transverse colon, and the transverse mesocolon. It is divided by these structures into anterior compartment and the posterior compartment. This is the anterior compartment, and this is the posterior compartment. Anterior compartment, in front of the lesser omentum, in front of the stomach, and in front of the greater omentum. This is the anterior compartment of the greater sac. Posterior compartment, okay, anterior compartment behind the anterior abdominal wall, posterior to the anterior abdominal wall. Posterior compartment, this is the posterior compartment, anterior to the posterior abdominal wall, yes, and the posterior to the greater omentum, transverse colon, and the transverse mesocolon. Subdivisions of the greater sac. The greater sac is divided by the transverse mesocolon, okay? Transverse mesocolon attached to the transverse colon into supracolic compartment and the infracolic compartment. This supracolic compartment contains the stomach, the liver, the gallbladder, the spleen, okay, and the duodenum. The infracolic compartment, this is the infracolic compartment. The infracolic compartment below the transverse mesocolon, it contains a small intestine and ascending and descending colon. So the greater sac is divided into anterior compartment and the posterior compartment. Okay? Anterior compartment in front of the stomach, posterior compartment behind the greater omentum, transverse colon, and the transverse mesocolon. It is subdivided into supracolic compartment and the infracolic compartment by the transverse mesocolon. The supracolic compartment contains stomach and spleen, liver and gallbladder. The infracolic compartment contains a small intestine, okay, and ascending colon and descending colon. Regarding the peritoneal recesses, peritoneal spaces, we have five spaces. The five spaces are lesser sac, omental bursa, and the lesser sac is the largest peritoneal recess. And then four paracolic gutters, two on the right side and two on the left side, two related to the ascending colon and two related to the descending colon. Duodenal fossae, three, and the three cecal recesses related to the cecum, and the subphrenic spaces, four subphrenic spaces, two in front of the liver and two behind the liver. Okay, so we finished with the lesser sac. Regarding the paracolic gutters, paracolic gutters, on each side of the ascending colon and the descending colon, the paracolic gutters, two right related to the ascending colon, one medial and one lateral to the ascending colon. So paracolic gutters, medial and lateral to the ascending colon, and also two on the left side, one medial and one lateral to the descending colon. So paracolic gutters, this is ascending colon, so this is lateral and this is medial, this is a descending colon, this is lateral and this is medial. So four paracolic gutters. Then duodenal fossae, the duodenal fossae are three. This is the fourth part of the this is the fourth part of the duodenum. Fourth part of the duodenum, and this is the jejunum, and this is the duodeno-jejunal flexure. The duodenal fossae are related to the fourth part of the duodenum. So three. This is the first one, superior duodenal fossa. This is the second one, inferior duodenal fossa. And this is the third one, paraduodenal fossa on the left side. Paraduodenal fossa, or left paraduodenal fossa. It is related to the inferior mesenteric vein. What is the clinical importance of the duodenal fossae? A small intestine may enter this fossae and get strangulated. So coils of small intestine may enter in a recess, and form internal hernia, which can lead to strangulation. So these are the sites of internal herniation. Regarding the cecal recesses, this is the cecum. The cecum is related to three recesses. This is the first one, superior ileocecal recess. Second one, inferior ileocecal recess. Between the appendix and the ileum. And this is the third one, ileo-retrocecal recess. This retrocecal recess usually contains the appendix, and also the clinical importance is they are sites of internal herniation, which can lead to strangulation. Regarding the subphrenic spaces between the liver and the diaphragm, the subphrenic spaces are potential spaces between the diaphragm and the liver. We have two anterior and two posterior. The two anterior subphrenic spaces are separated by the falciform ligament. This falciform ligament of the liver separates the two anterior subphrenic spaces, left anterior subphrenic space and right anterior subphrenic space. The two posterior subphrenic spaces, one on the left side and one on the right side. The one on the left side is the lesser sac. The one on the right side, between the liver and the kidney, it is the hepatorenal space. The left posterior subphrenic space is the lesser sac. Subphrenic abscess. Subphrenic abscess is accumulation of pus in the left or right subphrenic space due to increased frequency of appendicitis or ruptured duodenal ulcer, or ruptured duodenal ulcer. Pus ascends to the subphrenic space via the right paracolic gutter. Okay, so the subphrenic apices is usually on the right side, is usually on the right subphrenic space. Okay, due to the increased frequency of appendicitis and ruptured or perforated duodenal ulcer. And thank you very much. Best wishes and good luck.